the will of God is amazing in South America. And one thing I wasn't taught. If you ever see a good fight, you might want to jump inside that piece of it every now and then. I'm behaving myself right now. Because I sure started to bring it down just a little bit to Jesus. I sure started to get to jump in and grab a little piece of that. Because has anybody in here? I'm gonna bring it down. Has anybody in here ever been down to a point when you didn't know what the next day was gonna bring? When you could turn to your family and friends and no one was around? But God made a way for it. When it seemed like you were all by yourself. Has anybody in here ever been down to a point? many, many years ago. We had a lock-in service back at Ebenezer in Mayfield. I'm going to mention, I'm going to come back to that in a second. But at that lock-in, she taught us a song. She kind of, they've always had a love pretty much for everyone. But there was something, a special place in the heart for young people. So we had a YPD, something, another, sleepover lock-in at the church on that particular Friday night. Of course, the song she taught us, and I still remember this very day, couple of children let us tell, the books of the Bible that we know so well, took us from Genesis and Exodus all the way down to Revelation. And of course, you know, as we go, we tend to remember certain things because those things kind of help make us who we are today. Of course, if I live, when I live to be 149 like I plan to, I'll always remember Pastor Black talking about the good and evil. One sermon that has stuck with me from a little boy until now. But we're here to celebrate God's gift in ministry that He has ordained to pass this way. And normally, we don't say nice things and show people love until they're stretched out across the front.
Amen.
A friend of mine recorded a song and said, "Give me my flowers while I yet live, so I can see the joy that they bring." Someone else said, "I'd much rather have a rose from the garden of a friend than the choice flowers when my stay on earth shall end. I'd rather have one rose now than a truckload when I'm dead." So I'm just, in the words of Dr. Matt King Carter, just the viciously proud, beloved, and slap happy glad to be able to come give flowers and to let them know how much they really mean to me. He made mention, of course, I'm getting all this out of the way now, that I'm not a fan of introductions, I'm really not. Because two things, number one, it feels uncomfortable for me to sit there and listen to someone talk about me, good or bad. And I had to sit there and just listen to it, it just makes it, because while you hear this introduction in your mind, you are setting the bar higher. And the more you hear, the higher you raise the bar. And of course, if you were to go down my list, I've done a lot of things, and I really don't want to put myself quite that high because I've seen sometimes expectations put me right next to Jesus. And Lord knows I ain't Him. Plus, I've also heard someone say one time before, and I just love it, it stuck with me. He who deserves an introduction doesn't need one. But he that needs an introduction doesn't deserve one. I'm not sure which one I am. And please do not tell me later, okay? Promise me that you won't tell me which one that I am. But we do thank God for this opportunity to be here in one of the most beautiful places that I've ever been in my life. And Lord knows I'm looking forward just to coming back down this way and just seeing more of what this area has offered, even though Dee Dee has been trying to get me here for years. I'm here now, and Lord willing, I will be back. 2 Corinthians, chapter number 7, chapter number 12, rather, and verse number 7. 2 Corinthians, chapter number 12, verse number 7. The God of our weary years and the God of our solitude, Father God, now we come, asking that you let us step back so that you may step forward. Father God, realizing that there is nothing in this flesh that is good. So Father God, right now, kill it. Let self die so that your spirit may live. Take now your servant out of hands of mine. Speak to us, speak through us. Give us what you want us to have. Consecrate me now to that service, Lord. by thy power of grace divine, let our soul look up with steadfast hope, our will be lost in that. And all of God's people say amen.
Amen.
Second Corinthians, chapter 12, verse number 7.
Amen.
Unless I should be exalted above measure, through the abundance of the revelation that was given to me, a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure.
Amen.
For this thing I besought the Lord Christ that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness.
Amen.
Most gladly therefore will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me.
Amen.
Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong.
Amen.
The J.B. Phillips translation hints that same verse that does so tremendous, however, with the revelation that God gave me, that in order to prevent my becoming absurdly conceited, I was given a physical handicap, one of Satan's angels, to harass me and effectually stop any conceit. Three times I begged the Lord for it to leave me, but his reply has been, my grace is enough for you, for where there is weakness, my power is shown the more completely. Therefore, I cheerfully made up my mind to be proud of my weaknesses because they mean a deeper experience of the power of Christ. I can even enjoy weaknesses, suffering, gravitation, persecution, and difficulties for Christ's sake. For my very weakness makes me strong in him. Amen.
Amen.
Thank God for my confidence. Thank God for my thorns. It is not uncommon to appreciate the positive side of life. Let's be honest here. We have no problem at all being grateful as long as the wind of circumstance are blowing in our favor. When every day is filled with sunshine and gentle breeze, you don't have to go out of our way to say thank you, Lord. Because we are programmed to respond to graciousness with gratefulness. However, the litmus test of our faith is not how we respond to the positive, but rather how we react to or in the midst of the negative. Let's be real. How often do we respond to bad times with a smile on our face? Now, please don't misunderstand what I just said. I'm not talking about after we process the information, take time to pray, take off our fleshly selves and slip into something more spiritually comfortable. I'm talking about right then and there. That very moment when our true selves begin to show their faces. One of my favorite sayings is, a faith that has not been tested cannot be trusted.
Amen.
I don't care how strong we think we are. Our strength has not been validated until we encounter an experience where it has been put to the test.
Yeah.
We don't know what we can handle until the time actually comes for us to endure some form of challenge.
Yeah.
Romans 5 puts it like this. We glory in tribulation also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patient experience, and experience hope, and hope maketh not ashamed. It's hard for us to fathom the concept that something good can come out of something bad.
Amen.
That positive and negative can coexist within the same entity. But alas, it is true. It is a tried and proven fact that positive things possess negative characteristics. And negative existences are endowed with positive qualities.
Amen.
It can be best stated that there is bad in the best of us. And good in the worst of us.
Yeah.
Now trust me, I know that it to do. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 5:8, in everything, give thanks.
Amen.
That means when things go wrong, thank God. When trouble press you down, thank God. When bad times knock you down, hard times weigh you down, and tough times hold you down, still, thank God. One way of looking at it goes like this. In the 23rd Psalm, verse number 2, David said that he maketh me to lie down in green pastures.
Yes.
The connotation here is that sometimes we don't know what's best for us. So sometimes God has to force our hands to get us where we have to be in order for us to walk in the fullness of what he has in store for us. You would drive that old beat-up car, riding on big pops and wheel blows, engine leaking oil by the gallon, burning gas by the gallon, got to keep your foot on the gas because if you didn't, the engine would shut off at the light. You were not going to let that car go because it was yours, bought and paid for. But something happened one day. You got rear-ended a T-bone. Now that car is towed. You didn't want to leave that house you lived in most of your life in, but all of a sudden, an electrical fire destroyed it and everything in it. You were content with that dead-end, low-paying, unappreciative job until one day you got to work together, pit slip sitting on your desk. None of these seem like places. But look at you now. Driving a brand new BMW. Living in a large house on an upscale side of town. Bringing in a six-figure salary. You are too afraid to step out of your comfort zone, so God had to force your hand in order to bless you. Sometimes our promotions are dressed in the garments of demotion, but the word of God is still true. All things work together for the weak. That's why the psalmist said in Psalm 119, verse 71, it is good for me that I was. This book, 2 Corinthians, in the theological realm is known as an apologetic letter. The term apologetic does not mean that Paul is apologizing for anything, but refers to the fact that Paul is defending himself in the midst of the attacks made against him and his ministry by his attacks. Looking back, we see that the book of 1 Corinthians deals with the divisions that were going on in the church. Saints suing saints, immorality, and Paul takes time to discuss these issues that were dividing the church. Hero worshipers. Folks were lining up behind certain preachers. Some said they were followers of Apollos because of the silver tongue art. There were those who said they were followers of Peter because Peter was one of the original 12. And there were others who said that we are followers of Christ. And so Paul says, well, let me get my 2 cents in. I'm glad I didn't baptize none of them. And just let me note here on this Sunday, on my way to heaven, all of the followers of Apollos, Peter, and Christ are not dead. And they're still living around dividing the body of Christ. I don't care what church you look at or go to, you will find some followers of Apollos there.
Amen.
Those who feel that because they got a little education. Y'all don't met folk like that.
Amen.
Those that followed Apollos were known as the intellectual group. And they felt that they had monopoly rights over the church. And Apollos best represented who they were. So they were one of the groups that were causing division within the church. But then you had this group that was followers of Peter. Because Peter was here from the very beginning. He was one of the charter members of the church. And how many of you know that churches are divided by old members and new members? And sometimes there are those who have been around the church for 40, 50, 89, 135 years who feel that these Johnny come late to the church shouldn't have anything to do or say about what's going on. But then there were those who said that we're followers of Christ. That's the super spiritual group, the high sanctified group, the perfect and pious group, who feel that they don't have to come summon the pastoral authority. I hear from God just like a pastor.
Amen.
I hear from God's prayer. We now find Paul sharing how God has manifested himself to and through him.
Amen.
Since he's been converted by way of vision and revelation. And as we approach our text, Paul is saying that in order that I don't get big here, just so I don't think myself, both myself as I really am, God threw a speed bump in my path. Something to slow me down. Unless I hold it too long and examine this passage, there are three reasons Paul shared with us within this text to help us understand the purpose of and why we should be thankful for our thorns. First of all, Paul says, I'm thankful for my thorns because it pulverizes my pride.
Amen.
It pulverizes my pride. How many of you have ever met somebody who just knew they had it going on?
Amen.
Sometimes people who know they had it going on can be some of those irritated, aggravated, and sickening people you will ever meet. I'm talking about people back in Southern South Carolina. I don't see that name, but back in South Carolina. Those are those aggravated people you ever run across of. And we got to be careful because as God blesses us, that we don't get puffed up in pride. Far too many of us, as we are blessed, have a tendency starting to look down on other people. Because in our minds, we think that they're not on our level. Beneath us are not as good as us. But let me tell you right now, please don't lift up your pride, because God will bring you down. There are some people, not only here, but there are some people, I've been there before. You got your new job, new house, and folk you used to hook up with, folk you used to deal with, folk used to hang around, you don't deal with anymore. Talking about, I got to hang with folk on my level.
All right.
You better be careful about being lifted up and caught up in pride. Pride is a dangerous thing. And I don't care how much God has blessed you, because just as he gives, he can turn around and take it off. You better watch your pride, man, because Proverbs 16 and 18 said, pride goes before destruction, and a haughty, arrogant spirit before a fall.
Yes,
sir. I say, I don't know about you, but I just don't like being around arrogant folk anyway. Because when you reduce it down to the lowest common denominator, you ain't nothing but dirt, just like me. All of us are made from the dust of the ground. And when we're down, we're all going back to the dust. From dust thou art, to dust thou shalt be.
Yes, sir.
Pride comes before destruction.
Amen.
Don't let the blessings of God, don't let God's blessings cause you to get the big head.
Right.
Again, I'll stick a pin in before I turn the corner.
All right.
It's not God's job to keep you from getting the big head. It's your job.
Your job.
It's not God's job. Do I need the Bible here? Okay. Matthew 23:12. He that shall humble himself shall be exalted. 2 Corinthians 7:14, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves. You still need more, okay? James 4:10, humble yourself in sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. It's my job to keep my head from getting big, to keep myself from being lifted up in pride. But if I don't, God will. That's why you better be careful singing some of these songs. If I'm too high, Lord, bring me down. If you don't believe me, look at Luke chapter 12, where he said to himself, you've done good. I've done good for myself. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tear out these bars and build bigger bars. I'm going to eat till you be mad. And the Spirit said, thou food this night. thank God for my thorn because, number one, it pulverizes my crown. Watch your text here. Unless I should be exalted above measure, through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan. Satan came to buffet Paul. The thorn did not come from God. The thorn came because God moved his hand and allowed the devil to strike Paul.
Keep pushing you.
When it pushes us, when it pushes you, because when it pushes you, It pushes me to pray. Paul says, I beg God three times. Now the number, if you actually look back at it, is an uncertain number. So what Paul is actually saying is, I kept on calling, and kept on calling, and kept on calling. Every time that thorn would flare up in my body, I kept on praying. I kept on praying and praying and praying. Paul said, I beg the Lord. Now, Pastor, I'm going to share a secret just between you and me, okay? I can tell by the way some people pray that they ain't got no trouble in their lives. When you ain't got no trouble in your life, you can pray pretty prayers. Our gracious Father and our God, thou who rules and super rules our world, thou who looked out into space one day and called worlds to twirl, and every planet in space took its rightful place. Thou who ordered a variety of blooming flowers transfigured into a marvelous attraction. But when I got trouble in my life,
I found it.
that you see now. These enormous pecs and this washboard underneath this washing machine. But whenever I go to the gym, I take my time and the first thing I get on is a treadmill. But as you look around at you, they have a machine for almost every part of your body. There is something there that builds up your cardiovascular strength. There is something there that you get on to help build up your leg strength. But I don't care how far exercise comes, there's one thing that has never, ever changed. And that is that long iron body with those 45-pound discs on the end of it. That barbell has not gone anywhere. And you know, one day as I was in the gym, getting the gun show ready, as I was lifting that bar up and down, the spirit, the Lord dropped something in my spirit. I'm sitting there sweating and pushing. But while I was there, God dropped in my spirit that the only way that you could ever get strong is to be up under something heavy. I look back over my life. There were lies told on me, and it was heavy. I've had six in my body, and it was heavy. There is no way to get stronger without feeling the pressure. And then, they've always recommended that you never, ever go lift weights without having someone to spot you. And you want to know that God is spotting us. Whenever the weight gets a little heavy, God is right there protecting you. God is right there leading you. God is right there guiding you. God is right there directing you. Look back on the time of life. Who you thought that you were going to give up? Who you thought that you were going to give in? Who you felt that run away? Who you felt that going to die? God preserved you. God maintained you. God kept you together. God kept you from drowning. If you had not been for God.
Thank you.
I don't care how good of a person you are. when you stand before that judge, the one thing that's going to matter is, was your heart right?
Yes.
Ask yourself a question. If my name was to be called right now, if at this very moment, I got to lay down and die, where would I spend eternity? If you don't like the answer, if you don't know the answer, this is your time to give your life to Jesus. As the rest of my life in this moment, as we live in whatever song is, I really can't catch it right now. We extend you the opportunity that you may come.
Storms gonna come,
To him be glory.